Hello and welcome to this innovation coffee break. My name is André Hildebrandt and I want to explain to you why I think that FMI 3 is really important for our industry. Let me start with a recap about FMI. What is it? FMI stands for Functional Mockup Interface. It's a standard defining a C interface. Basically, you have a C shell and you can put any code inside of it. This enables you to generate a container, the so-called Functional Mockup Unit, or FMU, and this container is able to be executed on any simulator who supports FMI. With that, you are independent of different vendors and you can exchange FMUs wherever you want to. That's the basic idea. So let's go a little bit into detail. FMI provides you four basic data types. It's real, string, boolean, and integer. And as you can see, these are scalar data types and you can do a lot with that, but you quickly run into some problems here. For example, when you have an integer array and you want to exchange it with another FMU, for example, then you need to flatten this integer array into various ports. This leads to many, many unnecessary ports, and it's really difficult to handle. And also, it limits your degree of freedom and how you want to create this FMU. It becomes worse when you want to exchange binary data, as you can see below. Also, the FMU provides only one clock. So there's only one rate you can execute the FMU. With FMU 3, everything is a bit different. So you can see here, there are a lot of new data types here. We are more specific here and we can also transmit arrays. So my example before, if you have an integer array and you want to exchange it with another FMU, you just take the whole array. It's much easier to handle. You get much more degree of freedom here. Also, binary data can be transmitted now. So you have something which is called an opaque binary port. This opaque binary port enables you to exchange binary data with variable size. So it's not fixed in this case. Also, you have more clocks. You can partition your FMU into several parts and execute each part only when it's necessary, which increases the performance. That's the basic idea. And I want to show you two applications for now, why I think this is really important. The first one is the so-called virtual ECU standard. Now with FMI 3, we have everything what we need to define a virtual ECU standard. We can use the binary port, for example, to exchange bus data. So when we want to have a bus simulation like a CAN bus or a LIN bus, we can use the clock for exchanging events to trigger certain messages, for example. With that, we have everything what we need to create virtual ECUs which are interoperable. So they can be exchanged in different departments using different tools. This is a huge, huge application. The second application here is from the ID domain. So just consider you have a system under test, maybe trajectory planning or something like that. And you have an environment model which generates ideal world data, the so-called ground truth. This ground truth data is ideal data of an ideal world. So you cannot really test the algorithm itself. So you can introduce in between sensor models. They basically consume the data, they modify it to get it more realistic at the end. With that, you're able to increase the testing possibilities of the system under test. So these are just two examples or two applications here. So FMI 3 allows you to create simulator-independent artifacts. So you can exchange your containers with everyone. This has been true before, but now you have new data types, various number of data types. You can exchange arrays, you can exchange matrices, binary data, or even clocks. This opens up a full world of new applications here. dSPACE is always trying to support all standards. And in this case, I have two examples. System Desk is able to generate virtual ECUs based on FMI, as well as Veos can simulate these FMUs. So you can use it right now already. So to get it a little bit less abstract, I have a little demo for you, which I want to show you here. As you could see in one of my slides before, I referred to OSI, or the Open Simulation Interface. The Open Simulation Interface, or short OSI, is a standard driven by ASAM. You can read more in one of these links. And the basic idea is that in the standard, a huge data structure is already defined using proto files. With that, you can generate code files which are included in the corresponding software. So you have the data structure in there, you fill it up with some data, and you can serialize it to a binary. This binary then is exchanged with another module, and there it is deserialized, and you can work with it. The example here is very simple. I use automotive simulation models. This is dSPACE model suite for automotive applications, like engine models, or like in this case, traffic environments. In this model, the whole environment is simulated. And the data is serialized into a binary, which is then transmitted to a sensor model. In this case, we used an object-based sensor model, which is the result of a research funding project. You can read more in this link. This sensor model creates binary data again, the so-called sensor data, and this is fed back to the automotive simulation models. As you can see here, only the sensor model is an FMU. The other one is a dSPACE proprietary format called Simulink Implementation Container, or short SIC. I use this example because I want to show that our containers are compatible with the new FMI standard. I already opened VEOS. So this is the VEOS GUI, and you can see that I already included ASM traffic. This usually takes some time. I didn't want to wait so long here. So now I will import the sensor model. So I can open it here, and here you can see. I just need to open and build. And as you can see now, it's compiling. This will take just a couple of seconds. The next thing what we need to do then is to connect the environment model with the sensor model. You see, the compilation is through and the state is valid. So now I have both models in here. And as you can see, when I open the tree here, then you can see that there are a lot of interfaces. And here you see the binary data output. This one needs to be connected to the sensor model. And then the output of the sensor model is fed back to the ASM traffic. I need to configure it here. So you can connect per drag and drop. That's all what we have to do. We can save, and that's all we have to do in VEOS. Now I switch to Control Desk. So this is Control Desk. As you can see, I already prepared the project. On the left side, you can see some details. Here, the VEOS file is shown. And you can see ASM traffic inside and the sensor model. So it's our actual model. We need to go online to start the simulation. This will take only a second, and now simulation is running. In the middle, you see a viewer we have prepared. So the lines are artificial, but basically everything else is based on the OC data. Let's start the maneuver here. The camera is following the ego vehicle here. The other boxes are the bounding boxes of the moving objects. These are defined by OSI. Everything else is not shown right now. As you can see here, only the objects are shown. Below, you can also see the number of the moving objects, stationary objects, and so on. So you can see there's a lot more which is taking place here. So our ego vehicle enters the construction site and just drives along with a fixed distance to the ongoing car. It's a simple example, but it shows that we can simulate the OSI here. I will come to the end of this video here. What I wanted to show you is two applications of FMI 3 and why this is very important for the industry. As you could see in the demo, you can easily connect an environment model with a sensor model. When you're using OZ, it's only one connection you have to draw, and all the huge data structure gets exchanged between both models here. So this is just one application, but it is a huge step forward. Thank you.
dSPACE, your partner in simulation and validation.